Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for coming today. I am excited to be here. Can you see my camera?
Yes, we can.
Me? Okay. So I'm very excited to have everybody here, and hopefully we're all going to have a good time today. What I'm going to try to do today is I have this organized in four parts, and I took the liberty to start off with a part that is called Fundamentals of Remote Sensing, which you probably were not expecting to necessarily get. Because the session is learning mapping with a specific software. But from the perspective of having taught drone remote sensing for 4 or 5 years now, it's really critical, in my opinion, to get a little bit of basic fundamentals of a huge branch of scientific inquiry called remote sensing, which is basically what you're doing when you're mapping with drone to map. So if you bear with me through a little bit of this, I want to do a little bit of a really solid introduction to remote sensing, put this in context in terms of what we're doing when we collect data with drones is called remote sensing. So if you go to any institution that offers a UAS or UAV, I'll be using these interchangeably, UAS, unmanned aerial systems or unmanned aerial vehicles or drones. So any program that will offer training in how to use, how to collect data with drones, how to use that data, how to make that data into products is going to start off with this because you are doing remote sensing. And remote sensing is one branch of geospatial technologies. It's sort of a parallel branch to GIS, which is geographic information science, and GPS, global positioning system. So all of these come together in us getting involved in the science of mapping with drones, we are essentially doing small-scale remote sensing. So what is remote sensing? Remote sensing is essentially any collection of data about or any measurement of an area or a quantity or a phenomenon or a process that is done without coming in contact with that specific thing that we're measuring, right? So everybody's familiar with satellites. Satellites are our number one source of remote sensing data. Then we have airplane remote sensing data. And then of course we have drone remote sensing data, or we have even weather towers, all of these kinds of things that collect information about things without coming in contact with them. It's called remote sensing. So what is critical when we do remote sensing with drones is to basically ask ourselves three main questions. What platform do we need to use depending on what we need to get out of that data? What information are we collecting and in how much detail and how frequently? And the reason I'm pointing these three things out is because these form the basic components of the science of remote sensing. So both satellites and drones, essentially what they do is they are platforms that carry instruments or sensors. You'll be hearing me refer to them as sensors that measure electromagnetic radiation. So anytime you put a drone up in the sky, right, and you start taking photos of the ground, because typically we'll be taking photos of the ground. Now there are people who do drone work to measure atmospheric processes, but when we're collecting data about the ground, what we're really taking a picture of is the reflected electromagnetic radiation. That is to say, the reflected energy coming from the sun. So that energy from the sun hits the surface, gets reflected back, it interacts with the surfaces, and what we're taking a picture of is simply that signature of how the sun's radiation interacts with the surface, okay? So whether we're talking about satellite remote sensing or drone remote sensing, we're talking about essentially measuring something about the surface of the Earth from above. Now, when we work with satellites, we have to worry about the atmosphere. There's a lot going on here. So we measure not only the surface, but also what happens in the atmosphere. But with drones, we, by flying so close to the ground, meaning our 400-foot ceiling, right, we basically just measure surface conditions at a given time, and we remove those atmospheric effects. In remote sensing, that is critical because that's what makes drones so powerful in their various applications. So when I say electromagnetic radiation, what I mean is, again, incoming solar radiation, that energy coming from the sun, if we were to break that down into a spectrum, we call it the electromagnetic spectrum. It goes from very high intensity, low wavelength gamma rays into X-rays, into ultraviolet rays, the stuff that we try to block out with sunscreen. And then we have this super, super thin section of that packet of energy that is our visible light, okay? That's what we perceive with our human eyes. And that's from about half a micrometer to 0.7 of a micrometer. It goes from blue into red. And then on the other side of that visible spectrum is infrared. Now, oftentimes on these drones that we fly, we have, all of them are going to have what we refer to as an RGB sensor. That's your red, green, blue. It's essentially being able to take photographs of what we see with our human eye and what we perceive with our human eye. So when we see those RGB photographs from a drone, they are sensing only this tiny, tiny sliver of that energy. And then we have the drones that can take infrared photos or near infrared photos. So we call them, right, we put a multispectral sensor on those drones that goes outside of the visible. And then I'm sure you all know, we have even those thermal, the drones that have a thermal sensor that goes even farther out into this infrared portion of the spectrum. So this is really important to couch what we're doing in this, okay? So basically, this is what we're sensing. We're sensing only visible light with a little bit of infrared. And sometimes when we have those dual thermal cameras, right, we go a little bit farther out to about 10 micrometers into the electromagnetic spectrum. And so when I say that this sun interacts with the surface, what actually happens is, so essentially imagine the whole package, right? From blue to green to red and into infrared, it hits a surface. Say in this case, it hits a tree. That radiation that's coming from the sun is being used by the leaves on this tree to basically photosynthesize and to make energy and cellulose and so on and so forth. So the tree uses this energy to make food for itself, essentially, right? But what it does is it absorbs, in making this food, it absorbs the green and the blue, the green, the blue, and the red, and very strongly sends back from the leaf structure, reflects back green and infrared, right? Well, what happens is we see the tree as green, but in fact, but the tree actually reflects a lot more of this infrared radiation that we can't see with our naked eye. So we see vegetation as green. But as soon as we put a multispectral sensor on a drone and we fly it over trees, all trees are basically, they all show up very, very much more strongly in that infrared. So they would show up as a different color depending on how we showed that infrared. And then there's the other important interaction, right, of this radiation with the surface is with water. So basically what water does is, if you imagine all of this radiation hitting a surface, water absorbs everything. That's why these arrows are so short, the infrared, the red, and the green. And it reflects very strongly in blue. That's why water shows up as blue. So really, all these colors that we're seeing, that we're sensing, that we're taking photos of with a drone are simply a result of physics. So there's physics, we have that solar radiation interacting with these different surfaces in different ways. So that when we actually go down to the bottom of it, what we can do with this, with these drone remotely sensed images that we collect with drones, is we can actually take these colors, right? Because we essentially, right, I'm telling you here that we're seeing these colors. And you all know, if you've looked at a satellite image, you've seen water blue, you've seen vegetation green, you've seen sediment and so on. So you know how these things look. But what we can do, and what's powerful about drone technology, is that it gives us, and it allows our students to tap into a very, very scientifically solid field of remote sensing in a very simplistic and sort of direct way, so that we can take these colors and turn them into numbers. We can turn them into quantitative measurements. So what that means is I can take all of those colors in an image, because they're basically stacked like pancakes, and I can extract numbers. And those numbers simply represent where on that electromagnetic spectrum that I showed you earlier, that surface that we're taking a picture of falls. So imagine that you're taking a picture of an area that has a bunch of grass, a bunch of pine trees, so coniferous, right? And a bunch of oak trees, which are deciduous. So if I take a photo of an area that has grass, oaks, and pines, usually what we wanna be able to do with these drone images is basically extract some data from them, right? We wanna be able to classify out what's grass, what's pine, what's oak, what's concrete. That's the number one use of why we do drone data collection sometimes. So the way we do that, the way we classify or the way we separate out these surfaces is by their spectral signature, by the way that they interact with that incoming solar radiation along the electromagnetic spectrum. I know that's a lot to say, but basically, again, is how they process, how they take in blue or green, and you see this is all vegetation. What is it going to do? It's going to spike in green because it uses the blue light, like I showed you here in this graph. Vegetation essentially eats blue and red. See, there's a major dip here at the red because that's what it uses. Vegetation uses that to photosynthesize, to feed itself. And then, as I said before, there's a giant spike in infrared, and this is why it becomes incredibly necessary when we do, say, precision agriculture. So if you have students who are gonna be flying drones because they want to go and work in agriculture and make crop production better, well, the way they do that, the way they're gonna be able to apply drones to agriculture is by taking advantage of this giant spike in the infrared. So they're gonna be using a multispectral camera on that drone, because all vegetation essentially spikes dramatically in infrared. And the reason it does is actually because it's a physical response of leaves. They have something on the bottom of each leaf called the spongy mesophyll that essentially reflects back this infrared as a mechanism to keep the leaves cool. Okay, so they essentially try, because infrared is basically heat. They have to stay cool, so they reflect, they send all of this part of the spectrum that hits them back. So if you do precision agriculture, you're going to need a multispectral camera. And what you're going to do is you're going to plot out these different, say, imagine these are crops, right? So then each crop, as you can see, all of these look different. And they look the same here, and they look the same here because they use it the same way. But then they look very different here. And then they look also different here. So what that means is we can take that information where they look different, right, quantitatively, and separate them out. And that is really powerful. That's what's powerful about remote sensing. You know, that's why there's no more, basically, there will be no more agriculture in the future without remote sensing, because you can go over your fields and take a bunch of photos and not only, and extract, again, extract the quantitative data from those photos, right? Put the numbers down. And then you can say, not only this crop is cotton and this one's alfalfa, but you can also say, in this part of the field, this crop isn't going to need phosphorus, or this crop's going to need nitrogen, because we can see that stuff also in images. So that's the bottom line of it. And then if you put up something a little bit more different than that, right? So if you look at water, what water, this is, the blue is for water. The green shape is for vegetation, and then this brown is for soil. So again, you see how very different these curves are now, right? So I mean, as I showed you here, vegetation all kind of looks the same, and there are very small portions of that spectrum where they look different. But when you start breaking it out and you start trying to tease apart soil, water, and vegetation, now the differences are dramatic, right? Water only reflects in the blue. That's why it shows up blue to us. And then you see the same vegetation reflecting here in green, and then in infrared, and soil being. So that's why when we look at an image, bare soil shows up really, really bright in the, shows up to our human naked eye. And see how high this curve here? So this is how bright something is. So the higher on this line, one of these curves is, the more that shows up bright for us. So that's really what there is to it in terms of why we use drones for different applications. And there are so many different applications that we can use drones for, right? So then in the process of using this, that's how we can see what's what by essentially understanding how one surface reflects relative to another surface, okay? So here again, the same thing, drone, satellite do the same thing. So there's the sun shining on everything. Here's buildings, paved roads, bare soil, grass, water, trees, right? They're all getting hit with the same sort of incoming solar radiation, but then they sort of reflect back to your sensor differently. Okay, so that was that. And then the other thing, that was the main sort of critical piece that I really have to get out there, make sure that we know this is the context in which we do all this drone work. It's a big context. And again, anytime we do drone data collection, you know, the next step is to take that small drone image and compare it to a big satellite image. And how we do this is through three important characteristics. And this is the only other background I'm gonna give you on the remote sensing part, because you will see these concepts everywhere. They show up when we do drone processing in Drone2Map all the time. I want you to recognize and kind of know what they are. So again, when I talk about a drone and a sensor, a drone essentially, or the UAS system is the platform, is the thing that carries the instrument. And the instrument can be my RGB camera, or the instrument can be a multispectral camera or a thermal camera, or it can even be a LiDAR, okay? So again, when we say drone or UAS, we can put any of these remote sensing sensors. They're all remote sensing sensors. They all do remote sensing. We can put even hyperspectral. When you talk about hyperspectral, you're talking about, you know, $200,000, and you're talking about some serious remote sensing that happens there. And as you know, sometimes we can put all these sensors on a drone. We can operate them in fleets, and the key is that we produce a huge amount of data that requires significant processing, and workflow is very important, as we'll talk about today. And just a little background here, as I'm sure you already know, because I'm assuming everybody here is FAA certified and knows that what we're talking about in this class and what y'all are working with and what I'm working with is a very specific type of drone, but there are many types of drones, right? So we have drones that span a huge range based on their size, the altitude at which they fly, and how long they can fly for. So there are the tiny mini nano vehicles, the vertical takeoff and landing drones that fall right here in between, and then the what we call the low altitude short endurance, the small UAS, the stuff that we're all certified to fly. Okay, so we know it's 1 hour, but they can fly longer. We all know they can fly longer than 1 hour. 1 hour as well. And then we have all the low endurance, the low altitude, medium, and high long endurance drones that we don't necessarily need to worry about. So again, to say that this is what we're talking about, the small UAS low altitude drones. And so, as I said, we can put a variety of different sensors on drones. Some of these sensors, and there are two main types of sensors. I mean, that's all there is to it, simplistically put. Passive sensors, and these are the guys, your RGB camera, your multispectral cameras, your thermal cameras. These all collect what we call passive energy, meaning they just take pictures of what any surface. So here's water, here's vegetation, here's bare soil. As I said, bare soil always shows up really bright in an image, and that's because it's capable of reflecting all of that energy in the visible spectrum. So it shows up to our eye as bright white, as opposed to water, which absorbs everything in that electromagnetic spectrum, and it shows up as dark, right? So these passive sensors essentially take these photos, and we can then take the photos and convert them to biogeophysical quantities. We can extract vegetation information, chlorophyll A, we can look at soil moisture, we can even look at precipitation and temperature depending on what the sensor is. So that's why it's so cool to do drone remote sensing. And then we have the active sensors, and these are basically, think LiDAR here or radar, okay? So any sensor, and as you know, folks fly LiDAR drones, not so much radar, that's still very expensive and really heavy to put on a drone, but even I have a LiDAR sensor for one of my drones. So that is what we call an active sensor because it sends out a beam of energy and it records a return from that, right? And what's cool about these kinds of active-based sensors and why they're gonna become increasingly important is that they can actually operate at night as well, just as well. They don't need sort of that incoming, that they don't need the sun to be able to see information, right? They can collect information without having the help of the sun like passive sensors do. And they also can penetrate through clouds and vegetation, which is super, really important. And that's why a lot of people use them, okay? So those are sort of my two main types of sensors. And then the other thing I said I would talk about is the three important concepts of spectral, spatial, and temporal resolution as it pertains to drone collected and satellite collected data. So when I say that a sensor that we put on a drone is multispectral, it means, right, that it has multiple little cameras in sort of built into one, right, multiple little kind of openings, and that when I take a photo of the ground, instead of having one photo that combines that sort of combines that red, green, and blue, so one RGB photo, I have one in the red, maybe one in the red edge, for example, which is an important one, in the green, and one in the blue. So I have multiple bands, right? I'm able to, instead of just getting one photograph, for the same photograph, I get 4 to 5 layers of data, so to speak, but in different parts of the spectrum, hence these breakdowns. See these breakdowns here? That means that if when a photo is being taken, instead of having a JPEG that is just the one photo I got of that area, I literally have 5. And I have one for each of these bands, but they have to be built that way, right? So that's why they cost a little bit more to have a multispectral. And then there's something like hyperspectral. And when they come from a satellite, these images have essentially, instead of having 5 to 7 sort of bands, they have 200 plus. And these are much more difficult to work with and process. Okay, so basically, the reason we split up the spectrum like this again is back to those graphs I showed you, is because that helps us differentiate and separate what we're looking at. That's it, okay? The spatial, when you hear the concept of spatial resolution, that's essentially the pixel size, right? And the spatial resolution of any image is what is the smallest unit being measured by my sensor? So if I put a drone up in the sky, depending on the elevation I fly that drone at, I'm going to get, say, 2 centimeters or 1 inch per pixel, right? That's the smallest indivisible unit that I'm gonna get out of that image. That's where I'm gonna extract my data from, or I can get 4 inches and so on and so forth. So that's what spatial resolution means, right? And to kind of give you a comparison, like, because we're talking about spatial resolution, most UASs were going to give us a spatial resolution of somewhere from, you know, 1 inch to about 5 or 6 inches, so 2 to 15 centimeters, whereas with satellites, right, and these are some of the most common satellites out there, some of the best resolutions are 0.5 meter to 1 meter. That's absolute. Those are the commercial satellites that actually cost a lot of money. So this is another reason, as highlighted here, of why drones are so important, is because they essentially add, you know, to this kind of imagery, and this is the same exact location, but at a different spatial resolution, just to kind of highlight and explain that, right? So look at all the detail we can see in this image versus this 30 meter Landsat. This Landsat is the strongest and the longest archive we have in the world of satellite images dating back to 1972. So we rely very heavily on these kinds of data. But what we can do with drone remote sensing is that we can essentially, you know, get 10 centimeters per pixel. So we can zoom way in and we can sort of use drones to fill in gaps that we didn't have before. And then the last concept the temporal resolution piece, which is very important in remote sensing, is essentially the revisit. So in satellite remote sensing, that's how long it takes for the satellite to finish an orbit across the Earth and come back to the same area. We don't have to worry about that with drones, right? Our temporal resolution with a drone is on demand, meaning that if say, when you start doing this work with students and students want to monitor, say, the health of a wetland nearby your campus, right? So if that's what they want to do, they're going to have to collect data every month. Then that's called temporal resolution, how often the data gets collected. And so, you know, again, for drones, it's on demand. It's however often it is needed. And sort of lastly here, just to kind of put it all back in perspective, here's a satellite, here's an airplane, and here's a drone, right? Again, all of this stuff, the reason we normally do drone remote sensing and we work with drones is because they fill in gaps that are left by collection from satellites and from airplanes. So you can kind of look at the important concepts that I talked about, that spatial resolution, the temporal resolution, and then, well, I'm not mentioning the spectral resolution directly, but it's under data types here, right? So typically from satellites, we get only multispectral passive data. There are some LiDAR satellites, but they don't function very well, and so on and so forth. So because of that gap left by satellite remote sensing and the fact that satellites fly so high up in the sky and so on, then we sort of fill in the gaps with some of these other platforms. And UASs play a really important role in this. So know that when you're training students to become UAS pilots and UAS data scientists, so to speak, they are well on their way to becoming data scientists, because UAS technologies and data collection and processing is part of a really much, much bigger thing. And so I think it's going to be important to highlight this, that hey, you can actually go and take data from airborne, from airplanes, like the data that NOAA is collecting of our coast all the time. You can be able to work with satellite data. So they'll be building up this understanding of remote sensing in a direct sort of microcosm way, and then they'll be able to go in and apply it to some of the other much sort of broader pieces. Okay, so quickly to wrap up this, so why do we do, again, this is it on the big picture, but why do we do drone remote sensing? I sort of highlighted some of these things. We can operate these drones over whatever study area we need at a very different scale, so we can have fly big missions made up of multiple sort of drone flights. We can fly a fleet of drones, but we can also fly in very small and constrained areas that we otherwise couldn't with anything else, right? We collect very high spatial resolution data, and this is critical, right? That's how I've been trying to sort of bring home, is that they are one piece, and they give us that spatial resolution that is unparalleled, and it's a revolution in what we can do with geospatial data. We can collect as frequently as we need to, and that's, again, my temporal resolution. We can customize our missions and use different sensors depending on what we need, and we can actually carry them in a backpack even, and fly where we couldn't put an aircraft. We can fly them in fire situations, in narrow canyons, and so on. So these are some of the main advantages, and this is why, again, drone remote sensing as one component of remote sensing is really cool and really critical, and I think an amazing thing for high school students to get into. But there are challenges, and the main challenges are that because of how small these drones are, the sensors, the payloads that we can put on them are we are limited, right? So we're limited by cost usually, and the fact that they lifting those sensors. There's still flux around the regulatory environment. Sometimes it's challenging to fly. So we're not having to worry about the entire atmosphere like we have to worry about with satellite remote sensing, but we still have to worry about, as you know, wind and rain and all that stuff. And then it's field intensive and difficult to georectify imagery sometimes. And it can be complicated and time consuming to process imagery, which is, I guess, why we're here, why we're doing this. Are there any questions? I just had a few more slides with some example applications before we jump into the next hour. I would like to spend talking about how we plan a mission in order to get the data we need, and what do we need to get in the field in order to actually properly process data. And I'll also do an introduction to photogrammetry, which photogrammetry is really the core of drone data processing. So really, I just wanted to make sure that I get across the point that I think this is really exciting, that I think when you start teaching students this, I think it's really important to keep track of the bigger picture, of the fact that this is part of a much, much bigger thing. And there are tons of jobs and tons of quite honestly, I mean, they're interested in where they're going to be able to go job-wise, right, at the end of the day. Lots of jobs that pay really well in this field, in this bigger field of sort of data science, remote sensing, with them becoming interested in drones. So
there is a question, and the question is, can you explain georectify?
So I will talk about that in the upcoming. So what that means is essentially, when we take these pictures with drones, right? So the drone is flying, say, let's say at 400 feet. You take photos that essentially reside with your sensor on your drone, with your camera, and they reside on your memory stick in your drone. When you pull out that memory stick from it, so those photos were taken at 400 feet. When you pull it down and bring it back and you start putting it into, say, Drone2Map, which is only one of the many softwares we can use, the software does kind of know, because when your drone is flying and it's collecting this data, it's also talking to satellites that have GPS on them. I think everybody understands that, right? The only way is that these drones can complete a mission like we want them to do, and they can collect this data in a way that we can then use, is because they are talking to GPS satellites. So at all times, the drone knows where it is, because it's got a GPS antenna. So then when a drone takes these photos, it takes them at 400 feet, but each photo has the GPS, the latitude and longitude, the GPS location of where it was when it took the photos. So what we have to do when we process the data is we essentially have to bring these images from 400 feet and stitch them on the ground. And not only stitch them to the ground to basically get what the ground looked like, whatever we were flying, but we have to make sure that we stitch them to the ground in the right place, relative to the earth, right? With the correct latitude and longitude. Does that make sense?
Beautiful.